Hallelujah. Praise the Lord, saints. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, we welcome everybody here tonight. Everybody watching live for Dom, Mapleton, Georgia. We thank all of y'all for viewing in tonight. Amen. Amen. We're going to read scripture led by opening prayer tonight. And then any testimonies, and then we're going to bring up our speaker for tonight. Amen? All right. The verse I'm reading is Psalms 119, verse 114. Thou art my hiding place and my shield. I hope in thy word, and the word of God is truly blessed. Amen? When I was reading that, it took me back to every time that I was doing something and never consulted with God to get God's word. So I had to deal with everything that I put up before myself. I had to deal with it myself. Amen. And he's my hiding place now. Everything I do, I try my best to do it in God. Even when I step out before him, he always called me back and say, "You didn't do that. You didn't do that right." He'll speak to me and tell me where I messed up at, and I have to repent and come back. Amen. But see, that's the word that we have in us, that it brings us back and we know better. It's that word. Amen. All right. Let's go ahead and pray before. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord God, Lord, we come to you tonight, Father God, and we just uplift your name, Father God. God, we speak these words out of our mouth, Father God. And we uplift your name, Father God. God, we use the power of the tongue right now to worship you, Father God, to thank you right now, to honor you on tonight, Father God, as you are worthy, Father God. God, there is no God like you, Father God. In the mighty name of Jesus, God, we uplift you here tonight, Ephadom, Father God. Oh, God, we just thank you for everything that you're doing, Father God, and that you already done, Father God. God, we thank you for leading us here, Father God, for watching over our households, Father God, for watching over our children, Father God. God, we thank you for watching over our apostle and first lady, Father God. God, we ask you for watching over Joshua, Father God, and Jasmine, Lord. Lord, we thank you for watching over the members in Mississippi at Faith Covenant, Father God. God, we thank you for watching over every leader, Father God, and member and guest that enters into our hearts and in this place, Father God. God, we thank you for answering every prayer that we come before you humbly, God, but bold, Father God. God, we thank you, Lord God, in the mighty name of Jesus, Father God. We thank you for answering every prayer, to giving us a voice, for hearing us out, Father God. As your word says, you are always there, Father God. God, we thank you that we can just get in peace and get in a place, Father God, while we're driving in a car, while we're in a workplace, while we're in the middle of the line in a grocery store, Father God, that we can just speak your name, Father God, and that you are there and that you can listen to us, Father God, that there is no place where we cannot find you, Father God. God, we thank you for that right now, Father God, and that you answer everything, Father God. God, there is no God like you, Father God, that we can come upon and just ask and request and make a request known in front of you, to you, Father God. God, and we thank you for that right now, Father God. We thank you for giving us the faith size of a mustard seed, Father God. And we just believe in that, Father God, over whatever we pray over, Father God, or that word that you give us, Father God, or even the word that you put before us, which is the blueprint, Father God. God, we thank you for that map, Father God. We thank you for leading us, God. We thank you for being for healing over 2,000 years ago, Father God. God, we thank you for giving us the tailored word here, Ephadom, to believe in faith, God, Father God, to believe in your word, Father God, to continue and giving us the secrets of your kingdom, Father God, giving us new revelation after new revelation after prophecy, Lord God. We thank you for that right now, Father God, because without you, we would be lost, Father God. God, we thank you, Father God, in the mighty name of Jesus, Father God. God, we thank you, God, for giving the apostle and the evangelist and the prophets here, Father God, the chosen word at that time to give to this house and to these people, Father God, to your people, Father. And we just thank you right now, God, as there is no God like you, God. God, we would like to come together right now as one, Father God, and pray over the children going back to school, Father God. Pray over the schools, Father God. Pray over the children right now, Father God. The ones in college, the ones in high school, middle school, elementary, pre-K, God. The daycares, Father God, we pray over them right now, Father God. God, we pray over everybody's workplace right now, Father God. God, we pray over every entrepreneur's businesses, Father God. The new ventures, Father God, and the ones that are already established, Father God. For the ever more increase, Father God. God, continue to give us the courage, Father God. Continue to build our faith, Father God. And we thank you right now, Father God. God, we thank you, we thank you, we thank you, God. And we glorify your name, Father God. Oh, God, we thank you for making it so plain and simple. So plain and simple. Oh, God, we thank you right now. We thank you in the mighty name of Jesus. That whenever we need a word, just like Isaiah preached on Sunday, that we can go to your word and you will speak to us. God, we thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for going before us for every trial and tribulation. God, we thank you right now in the mighty name of Jesus. Oh, God, we uplift you. We thank you, Lord, in the mighty name of Jesus. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, amen. Glory, glory. We got testimony time. Any testimonies in the house? I know I'll start with a testimony. Me and my wife, we have been trying to get this health permit and stuff going on for our entrepreneur business, the snow biz. And we had to take a lot of turns. They were telling us go here, there. They were telling us no. And at times, I felt like, well, just forget it. But then God wouldn't let me forget it. He said, keep pressing your way. He said, if I told you this and I allowed this to be open and you got everything easily, don't you know I will get you your permits just that easier? And I said, Lord, you're right. I said, let me be persistent and keep going. Well, today when I walked into church and I got the envelope, I got both the permits for the business. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. I don't know if y'all ever tried to get some permits for health, food, buildings, inspection. I mean, it's a nightmare. It could be a nightmare, but through God, it's easy. And now that I think back at it, it wasn't even that hard. He put all the right people in the right place. I remember Zaya telling me they were coming in here and they were picky about the ramp and each rail coming up on the side right there for the church. Amen. They can be picky. Amen. So we just thank the Lord for that. We thank him. Any other testimonies? Testimony? Come on down, Messina. I really can't. The light's so bright I can't see over there. Amen.
Hey, y'all. I was just thinking back on some things that I had prayed to God about, like the gift of healing and for him to be able to speak to me to help someone else. And I thank God for the manifestation of what's been taking place. Just recently, I had a friend who was on dialysis, but she just received a kidney transplant, and so the kidney that's in her, it was causing her body to react with swelling just because it was foreign. And I remember seeing her feet, and all I could see were like the toes part because her feet were so swollen. And I remember before I got out of the car, the Lord told me to just lay my hand on her leg and just to speak a word. And so I got out and did that. And I thought it was going to be like instantaneous. But when I talked with her, the next the 2 days after, she said the swelling was completely gone. And when I actually seen her, I don't remember the last time I actually saw her feet without being swollen. And I just thank God for that. And then also a lady at Walgreens, the Lord had told me to lay my hands on her as well. And she looked so distraught. And so I asked her if I could pray with her. And she just began to pour out. And I laid my hands on her. And she looked down. And I remember her reaction was, "Oh my gosh, it's happening already." And so I just began to praise God right there outside. And I just thank God for supernatural works that manifest in the natural.
Amen, amen. I got Curtis coming up for testimony, followed by Vieta.
Okay. 3 minutes. You got the timer, okay? 7:45. I bless the Lord tonight for God's greatness, His mercy, His compassion towards me. Just want to be brief. As you know, I was working for 3 months, and you know, I didn't get like pastor yet with the faith or Isaiah, but it was a toiling 3 months. But thank God that He has opened up a door for me that I start employment on the 15th in an area that I have dealt with, but I don't know. I've never worked in the industry, but to God be the glory, it doesn't take long to learn. And I thank God for the opportunity for opening up the door and providing for me and my family. Also, 3 weeks ago, my wife was laid off for her job that she did in the daytime. So I said, you know what? I'm going to write your resume out, and we are going to send it out. So I sent out her resume for her. And today she got an offer for a management position in higher than what she was doing before. So I thank God for that. And to add the ice cream, I had applied, didn't hear back, for a program, a PhD program in organizational behavior. And I got the news today, I got accepted to the program. Amen.
Amen. Amen. So let me clarify that. We would like 3 minute testimonies. But when the Holy Ghost take effect, you let God do what God got to do. Amen?
Right. Praise the Lord, everybody. I just honor God because He is truly good, and His mercy endure forever. Amen? Amen. I just want to say, I knew that the job that I have right now, that God orchestrated it and that it was for me. But, and so one of the blessings is that I get to talk to students, young people. And I had the opportunity to talk to this young lady. She's a graduate of Penn State. And when I tell you, on fire for God, it was such a pleasure to talk to her, and I really tried so hard not to say God, Jesus, Holy Spirit. I was just like, yeah, and HS, you know, who we follow, and I tried so hard, but I just couldn't hold back. I ended up just saying, listen, God has ordered your footstep. Let Holy Spirit lead and guide you. But I just thank God, and I just realized, I was like, man, I was like, it's these kind of testimonies, is this type of event where I get to talk. And when I tell you, she was eating every word that I was saying to her. And so I just thank God for the opportunity. I thank God for purpose, for being in my purpose. I thank God for this journey. And although in the journey, there are trials, there are different things that we experience, but it is in the journey that you find your purpose. It is in the journey that you learn who you are. It is in the journey that you learn who God is. And so I thank God for the journey. Last thing, that is, I went home last not this weekend, the weekend before. I went home and I stayed until Monday. And so I had to go and speak to some people at home, and just to share, they're going to change the name of the high school library to my mom's name. And so I'm so excited. And when I tell you, that is part of my journey, because I look at all the work that she did that is actually speaking for her. And that's my goal, is that the work that I do, that it speaks for me when I'm gone on, that I be a blessing, and that the blessings just continue to flow. And I'm gonna do my part in following the plan that God has for me. So I just wanna say thank you, thank you, thank you to God. He is so good, amen.
Glory, amen. See, God said, working in the vineyard. I know when I'm with preacher always working. Yeni always working. Curtis always working. Vieta working. And I was like, God, I want to get out there. I was so eager. And God said, at a set time, because you'll get out there and some people hurt your feelings. And you better be hearing from God. You better have the right timing. Amen. Any other testimonies? All right. Well, we're going to bring up the speaker tonight. Isaiah laid the mantle down, laid the way, plowed the way for Mr. Keon Hackett. Amen. Come on up, Keon.
Hallelujah. Come on, y'all can do better than that. Hallelujah. You know, I like when somebody bring me up. I want somebody to be excited. And just like I'm coming up here, I want y'all to be excited. I'm up here. So I'm going to introduce myself. How about that? I'm going to introduce myself. Coming all the way from Columbus, Mississippi. Come on, keep clapping. He was a sinner saved by grace. Y'all put y'all hands together for God's chosen. Keon Hackett. Hey, y'all go make a little noise for me. Woo! Hallelujah. I'm telling y'all, man, we got an echo. But you know, Isaiah, he tried to call me today. I was a little busy and told him I'd call him back. And I called him back. He sent me the voicemail, said he'll call me back. Then my phone went off. Can you preach tonight? I like, man, I wouldn't even go on to church tonight. But what the Lord has something different for me. Bless you, Drew. I said, yeah, I could do that. Now keep in mind, I try not to, you know, I ran for so long, and now when I'm called upon, I try not to shy away from what God has called me to do. And my granddaddy used to tell me, if you stay ready, you ain't got to get ready. So I told Memory, I said, you know, I got to go teach now. She said, you got a word? I said, I almost told her, I always got a word. But that would have been a lie. But I didn't know what I was going to talk about. And God is like, I was going to talk about one thing, and I was like, nah. Now I'm going to talk about something else, and then, nah. And God pressed this word on my soul. And I really, really hope y'all get something out of it, because it's very important and it's very needed in the church. Amen. Oh, gracious and merciful Father in heaven. God, right now as I come to you, God, I come to you as humble as I know how, Father. God, I ask that you crucify Keon right now, God, and let your word ring free, God, to your people, God. Father God, use me, God, like only you can, Father God. Father God, let the word fall on good soil, God, that may, Father God, spring forth the fruit that you need, Father God, in this time, God. Now, God, I thank you right now for using me, God, and placing your mantle on me during this time. In Jesus' name, amen. Our scripture is going to come from Luke chapter 5, And we're going to start about verse 17. Will everybody please stand for the reading of the word? It says, one of those days, as he was teaching, there were Pharisees and teachers of the law sitting by who had come from every village and town of Galilee and Judea and from Jerusalem. And the power of the Lord was present with him to heal them. And behold, some men were bringing on a stretcher a man who was paralyzed. And they tried to carry him in and lay him before Jesus. But finding no way to bring him in because of the crowd, they went up on the roof and lowered him with the stretcher through the tiles into the midst in front of Jesus. And when he saw their confidence in him, springing from their faith, he said, man, your sins are forgiven you. And the scribes and the Pharisees began to reason and question and argue, saying, who is this man who speaks blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God alone? But Jesus, knowing their thoughts and questioning, answered them, why do you question in your hearts? Which is easier to say, your sins are forgiven you, or to say, arise and walk? But that you may know that the Son of Man has the power of authority and right on earth to forgive sins. He said to the paralyzed man, I say to you, arise, pick up your litter, and go to your own house. And instantly the man stood up before them and picked up what he had been laying on and went away to his house, recognizing and praising and thanking God. Isaiah, could you go back to me for me to Luke 17, 5, and I want to say it was about 18. Go back one more, I'm sorry. Okay, and it said, pay attention to this. It says, one of those days, as he was teaching, there were Pharisees and teachers of the law sitting by who had come from every village and town of Galilee and Judea and from Jerusalem. And the power of the Lord was present with him to heal them. If I had to pick a topic for this, the topic of the message would be, take me to the King. Take me to the King. What's important in this message is the fact that these men, the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, what was funny to me is that the scripture says that the power of God was on Jesus. Y'all can be seated. I'm sorry. Y'all can be seated. It said the power of God was on Jesus to heal them. So the power of God was on Jesus to heal the Pharisees and the Sadducees. But instead of them getting what they need, they began to criticize Jesus for what he did for somebody else. A lot of times in the church, and I'm not even talking about in the world, in the church, instead of us, let me back up. So these men brought their friend, and they couldn't get him through to get to Jesus. So they cut out, it said the tiles. What they mean tiles, they mean the shingles. They removed the shingles and put a hole in the roof and let him down in front of Jesus so that he could be healed. And notice this, the Bible don't even say that that man, the paralyzed man, was a believer. It don't even say that. But the faith of his friends healed him. The faith of his friends healed him. What kind of friends do you have? When is the last time your faith moved God to do something for one of your friends? I say this. I've been in here for Dawn for 20 years this year, and I want to say that sometimes, you know, as people, as believers, as Christians, or whatever you want to call yourself, sometimes we find ourselves, instead of taking our friend to the king, we talk about him to somebody else. We talk about him to somebody else. And what is that doing? What is that doing for your friend? I'm gonna tell you. I pride myself in being a person that people can come to me and talk to me, and I'm not gonna run and tell their business because it's not mine to tell. I pride myself in being a person that my friends, I'm gonna fight for them just as hard as I fight for myself. When I say that, I mean, I tell y'all all the time about Isaiah. Isaiah started his business, and even before he started FMP, when he was still, you know, just doing it on the side, I would meet people, and they would say, man, I just need somebody to do this. I need somebody to do that. Oh, man, call my brother. Here, this is number. Isaiah go to the people house. Hey, man, I just left your friend house over here on such. I said, who? He said, man, you know the person? I said, man, I don't know them people. I don't know them. I just gave them your number because I know they're what you do. But my faith in what Isaiah is capable of doing has brought him business. I had a friend call me and asked me about doing something. And he said, hey, man, do you know somebody that can do this? And what he asked me was, his family owns a glass company. They big all over the world. I didn't realize they was as big. Isaiah actually told me how big they really are. And he said, you got somebody that can put a GPS inside of a truck for me. I said, man, and he knows Isaiah because I sent Isaiah to his house to do something else. So I said, I think Isaiah can do it. And I called Isaiah. And Isaiah, if y'all don't know Isaiah, like Isaiah do car audio, but he really don't like doing it. So I said, Corey called me and he want to see if you can come out to the job and put a GPS in the truck for him. And Isaiah said, man, I said, Zaya, before you say no, just go look at it. All right, I go look at it. He went and looked at it. Isaiah said it ended up being pretty easy. And he did it. But him putting a GPS in the truck has turned into him taking over the contract for the cameras, adding cameras all over the place. Them the kind of friends you want. There's not gonna be jealous of you. There's not gonna worry about what you're doing and how you're doing it, but they want to help you to grow. Them the kind of friends you want. Anybody that's my friend, anybody that I know, if somebody called me and say, hey, listen, I need somebody to do this. Recently, actually Sunday, somebody had hit me up. She was like, hey, didn't you say you know somebody that got sprinters? I said, yeah, I do. I plugged with Anthony. See, that's what friends do. Like I say in this particular text, this man, faith did not heal him. We don't even know if he believed in God. We don't even know if he believed in Jesus or what his teachings or what Jesus was giving out. We don't know if he believed in it. But what happened was his friends, look, see, them the kind of friends I want, y'all. Because I'm going to tell y'all something. I ain't perfect. Not by a long shot. Sometimes I'm a little more, it depends on what day you catch me, on whether or not that I will prophesy to you. Because some days I may use some choice words. Or whether or not if you make me mad, I'm going to pray for you. I'm being honest. I mean, because to me, I tell it was a guy that worked with me at the police department, and he didn't believe in God. And let me ask y'all this. How many of y'all would truly deal with a person that didn't believe in God? You knew this person don't believe in God. And you would deal with them. I'm just crazy enough to deal with them. I had a couple friends, people that were my friends that didn't believe in God. But y'all know what I did? Showed them love. Showed them love. I told him one time, I said, hey, he said, he asked me something. And I said, man, you know, sometimes that's just how God is. He said, you keep saying that, man. Why you say? I said, man, let me tell you something. And I started telling him my testimonies. Now keep in mind, this guy, he was his family, they, you know, he drove older cars. His family was barely making it. And I said, man, God, I said, man, just stay faithful. God will bless you. And, you know, he'll look at me like, but guess what ended up happening? Yeah, the words that I spoke over him came to pass. He ended up getting a job making over $10,000 more a year than he was making working at the police department. Now, he might not see it like that, but the words I spoke over him came to pass. What kind of circle of friends do you have? Ask your neighbor, say, what kind of friends you got? Because in this particular text, these people love him so much that they got on the roof and lower him down. Let me tell you, I'm going to be honest with you. I love Isaiah. I love Curtis. Roy, I love all y'all. I'm not climbing up there on that roof of y'all. Now, I carry you out the front door because, for one, I just don't think some things are made for big people to do. Climbing on top of a roof is one of them things. I hold a ladder while somebody carry you up there. But I got to stay in my lane. I got to stay in my lane. I got to know my strengths and my weaknesses. But in the text, you got the Pharisees and what preacher said, the Sadducees. They're sitting up there and they watching it. They watch this man get healed, and instead of rejoicing with him, they were mad. That go to show you, everybody ain't gonna rejoice with you. I heard a preacher say this. He said, you know, if you slam your hand in the door, your legs go, you gonna jump, you gonna do run, you gonna do everything, but your legs weren't affected by being slammed in the door. Your feet weren't affected by being slammed in the door. But when one part of the body hurt, the whole body gonna feel it. So if you connected, if you truly connected, if your friend going through something, you're gonna feel it too. If they're in the body, if there's a true connection. Isaiah done been going through the thing about the house. Man, I seen them so many houses. I know you get tired of them because someone be in Douglasville and he don't want to go to Douglasville. You know, but I'ma look for houses. I'ma do what I gotta. I'ma do try to do what I can do to help them. Anybody in here? They ask me for help. It ain't nobody ever came through for Dom and said they asked me for help. I ain't help. It ain't nobody that came through here and say, well, because of Keon, I left the church. Well, ask yourself, what kind of friends you got? What kind of friends you got? And this ain't no look at me sermon. I promise y'all, it's not. But I can only, the preacher said, your message. The stuff that you go through is the stuff you teach about. I'm sitting here, and as I'm looking at this text, and I'm like, these guys were so determined to make sure their friend got what he needed. They wouldn't be denied. They said that they tried to come through other ways, and they could not get through. They couldn't get it through the doors. They tried to push through. They couldn't get through. And that's how packed it was. The scripture before this said that the people crowded around Jesus so much that it bagged him up to the water. And he saw two ships. And he got on one of the ships to continue preaching to the people. But that's how many people were there to seek God, to seek Jesus, to hear his teaching. And then you got this group of men that come through. One translation said that the man was on a couch. Now, can you imagine carrying a couch on top of the roof and letting a man through the roof on a couch? You know, I believe, it ain't in the scripture, but I believe them men was telling that man, oh, you're going to get healed tonight. Oh, you're going to get delivered tonight. And like I said, so many people, man, that we have to value the people around us. When God put people around you, when God put people in your circle or on your team, we got to value their presence and what they bring to the table, because sometimes you have to ask yourself, I find myself cutting people out of my life. I stopped dealing with a whole lot of people. Just don't talk to them. You know, I don't text them, don't call them. Because you have to look at the value that people bring to your life. And you got to ask yourself this. What kind of man, what kind of friend was this paralyzed friend that they felt so compelled to do that for him? Think about that. This man was paralyzed. The Bible said he was paralyzed, confined to a bed. And they felt so compelled to help their paralyzed friend. Ask yourself what kind of friend you think he was. I guarantee you he wasn't what they call negative Nancy. He probably, you don't know how many times he probably hyped them up. Hey, man, listen, man, we've been fishing all day, man. We ain't caught nothing, man. We got to feed up. Man, you going to do it. You going to be able to do it. Man, he was probably a positive friend. He probably spoke positive stuff over their life, but it still don't say he was a believer. Some of us don't want to be friends with people that ain't believers. If they don't believe like we believe, if they don't feel the way we feel, they don't want to befriend them people. But I'm going to tell y'all something. I got friends, all kind of friends. And, you know, and sometimes I tell my kids, you just say, Daddy, you got a lot of friends. I said, no, baby, Daddy just know a lot of people. Because everybody's not meant to be called your friend. The Bible says you have friends if you show yourself friendly. So because I'm a friendly person, people tend to talk to me. People tend to befriend me. But just because I'm your friend don't mean you my friend. I lost some of y'all with that one, then. I lost some of y'all with that one. How long are you? Y'all know y'all got that friend that y'all always there for them, but if you call them now, they ain't there for you. How many of y'all got friends like that? You to help people, you to help them. You know, you friendly to them. You know, when they call you, you there for them, you praying for them. When they call you, you stop what you're doing and you answer the phone and have press service right there on the phone. But when you lose your job or when you go through something and you call them same people, hey, man, I'm a little busy right now. I can't talk to you. So them the kind of friends I cut off right there. Them friends, every time you got these, you the one reaching in your pocket. Them the kind of friends I don't need. I got some guys I deal with. And, you know, as long as we hanging out and stuff like that, we good. But I started talking to him about business stuff, doing business. And I told him, I said, man, listen, man. I said, man, it's more of us being friends than just hanging out in the neighborhood. Man, let's tackle some of this. Let's do this. They don't want to do that. So you know what I did? I pulled back from them. I don't hang around them like I used to. I'm telling y'all, God is setting us up for something so great. And if my granddaddy said this, he said, boy, if you got 9 broke friends, you're going to be the 10th one. And I never understood that as a child, never understood what he was talking about. But basically he told me back then that your circle determines where you're going. The people you hang around with determine how far you're going to go. If you hang around a whole lot of people that's always negative, yeah, what's going to happen? That spirit going to get on you. I want friends that going to take me up on the roof. Now, I know I'm a little heavy. Now, they're going to take a bunch of y'all to get me up there. But I want some people that are going to take me up on the roof and take me to the king. And listen, by taking me on the roof, that don't mean physically carrying me up there. That means when you get in your prayer closet, call my name out. I don't want the people who say, I pray. You pray for me. Yeah, I pray for you. I pray for everybody. Well, my name ain't everybody. My name is Keon. So when you're in your prayer closet, call Keon's name out. Hallelujah. Come on, man. Y'all got to feel this thing. I'm going to tell y'all, this particular text, it really, really, really spoke to me. Like, it really made me feel like I had to look at myself. Like, dang, am I that friend that would carry my friend? And that's why I brought up all the stuff that I say, you know, how I treat my friends, because I know that I'm their friend, that if you call me at 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, I'm going to be there. But do you got, do you, what kind of friends you got? Do you got friends like that? Do you got a lot of friends like Keon? I've heard pastor say, you know, when he was going through, and I promise y'all, I didn't know till he preached about it. But I just know that God pressed him on my heart. Hey, call him. Man, pastor, let's go get something to eat. He was fighting depression. Let's go get something to eat. Pastor, let's get out of the house, man. Get out of the house. I had to take him to the king. I had to turn him over to God. I prayed for him. Sometimes, you know, in life we meet people that God didn't mean to be for us to be around forever. But when you're around them people, when God, see, I'm going to tell you, as us in here, when we encounter them people, we supposed to be them kind of friends. That's what we supposed to do. We ain't supposed to rag them out, talk about them, dog them out. That's what the world do. We supposed to look out for each other, strengthen each other, hold each other up. Amen. Listen, I'm not one of them that's going to tarry for a long time. I'm a helicopter, up and down. I don't need a long runway to take off or land. I've given y'all what y'all have given me, what God have given me. And I ask y'all to pray my strength in the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord, Deacon Hackett. A couple things he said. We weren't put on earth by ourselves to deliver ourselves. We not here, we can't do it by ourselves. We need help. And I think a lot of times we go through pain, we get hurt by people, we love, that's close to us, and then we get this little loner attitude, like we can do things by ourselves. But sometimes we need the help of others. God has used other people in your lives to help us. But sometimes we have a little attitude. We don't want to answer the phone. We don't want to answer texts. We don't want to respond. We don't want to come out the house. We don't want to do nothing for our brothers and our sisters. And, man, that's kind of sad. It's sad for me to preach the word here on a podium, but walk by somebody that need the word, and I don't say nothing to them. It's sad for me to have some money in my pocket and walk by a dude and see a dude on the street that needs some food and don't offer to buy him something to eat, but I say I love God. But we do that. I can't imagine, like, okay, like, if Keon, if he needed Jesus, like, man, you know, I hate heights already, you know what I'm saying? So if I get you up there, you know I love you, because I hate heights, you know what I'm saying? I do that because you my man, you know what I'm saying? If what is it to be successful in this world by ourselves? You don't have no friends. You don't have nobody to share it with. Is it really that important to be that successful alone? God uses somebody in the earth to do what he need to do. He even used somebody. He can do it by himself if he wanted to. So why is it that we try to do everything by ourselves? I'm looking at this scripture. This is good, man. This you got friends that care about your healing. Is it anybody we care about enough that we know need help right now that we praying for other than ourselves? Because right now, I'm going to be honest, man, it's even as a minister, man, it's hard to even open the book to read to get the word from God sometimes. Even being in a situation where you know you need to hear from God. I'm in a hotel right now, even though it's nice. I don't want to be there. But it's nice, and you know, God has been pressing on me to open up the book and read and read and read, and I read during the day when I'm in the van, but when I get back to the room at night, I find everything in the world to do except read, and you would think I would read being in the situation that I'm in. It's distractions. I heard from a preacher, he said, we need to turn off the notifications on our phones. Because all that does is distract us. Try one time to sit down and read and pray, and look how many distractions are happening. People call you not even know that they're bothering you, but they're calling you. Then sometimes we use this excuse, I got to set the mood, I got to get my worship music right, I got to get all of this right. All of that is a distraction too. Think about it. Now you sitting there, you got to play your favorite song, and while you worshiping, you listening to the words of the song, and you miss God. Think about that now. Are we really listening to hear a word from God? Or are we hearing the music and we crying out and we telling God all the stuff we going through and God is speaking, but we hadn't heard anything because I'm trying to set the mood? I sat in my van because I couldn't sit in the room because the dogs won't leave me alone. But I sat in my van just to get a little bit of quiet and say, God, if I need to hear something from you. Do I take this house way over here? Do I take this house way over there? I'm not trying to impress nobody. I'm trying to be right in the groove where you want me to be so I can still stay where you want me to be so I don't mess up. I got to hear from you, God, but I got to shut everything out to hear from you. Then sometimes God will have Keon, which I'll be thinking, I'll be like, 00 Negro, what's up? And then he give me a word. And for y'all that know Keon, most of the time, 98% of the time, he ain't serious. At least 98%. And when he gets serious for 1 minute and a word come out of, oh, that's God right there. Okay, that's what I needed. That's what I needed. Okay. I hear you. I was talking. I got these projects going on, and one of them is this glass company. And I'm adding cameras, and I added 4 IP cameras. Until the 44 they already have, and then I did something, and 16 cameras disappeared. And this is in a neighborhood where they don't have a homicide on the parking lot, they don't have a husband and wife out there fighting, somebody don't stab somebody with some glass, you know, so they need all their cameras, and 16 of them done went down, and it's 12 o'clock on a Thursday night. So I called Tamika, I told Mike, I'm about to cry in there, like Jesus, like you gotta help me get these cameras back up. I'm stressed out, but I'm trying to fix it myself instead of relying on the man that I know everything. You know what I'm saying? I made a few phone calls, you know what I'm saying? But at 12 o'clock at night, I mean, who gonna help you? And this was a job that Keon gave me, so I know the guy, and I'm trying to do the right thing, and I'm trying to make a good impression, and trying to take care of things, and I'm stressed out, and once I got in this little room and got peace and quiet, then God started to move my hand. I told Keon, I said, man, God fixed this. I didn't even rely on tech support. God fixed it. I'm not going to act like I'm that smart, but God fixed it. But sometimes we have to get in a place of quietness where we can hear from God. Turn off your Maverick City music. Your Donnie McClurkin, your Kurt Franklin, because at the end, God is trying to talk to us, and he don't need music to talk to us. He don't need a worship service to talk to us. So that message right there, Keon, yeah, you know, stay ready, man, stay ready. But when Pastor called me, I called you first, then the next one I called was Dr. V. I said, man, you know, I do this if I have to, but I got help, so I'm going to call somebody. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to call somebody. I told Dr. V, I said, Keon ain't on the schedule this month, so let him go. And God had a word in you. Amen. Hey, give Deacon Hackett, Overseer Hackett. I'm sorry, Overseer. Overseer, I apologize, Overseer. At this time, Vieta, you got something? You got something you want to say quick? You know what I'm saying? Okay. Mother Austin, you got something? Because you be, you know, you secretly be preaching. I know you know what I'm saying? I know you got a word. Oh, you ain't got no word today. Okay. Keep Pastor King, can we, you turn off?